we haven't met, my name is Jordan, one of the pastors here. And today we've got about an hour service planned for us to reflect and commemorate the death of Jesus. Why did Jesus die? It is a question that I get asked all the time. And today is Good Friday. And as followers of Jesus, this is the day where we commemorate the brutal crucifixion of our beloved Jesus, and we call it good. Often Jesus' death is associated with the idea of salvation, and you hear that a lot in context around this. And the word salvation means to be saved or to be delivered from harm. So in some way, Jesus' death in some cosmic way brought our deliverance. But what does that exactly mean for you and I today? See, the reality is many in church contexts like this, we often associate the word salvation with the forgiveness of sins, and it absolutely means that. And that's an aspect of salvation, but the word is much more than that. It has a fuller meaning. In fact, according to the New Testament, the writings of Jesus, and the words that are expressed around what salvation means, it's more adequately and wholly represents salvation means life. In fact, this is what Jesus says in John 10, I have come that they may have life and they may have it more abundantly. That Jesus' salvation has come to bring us a fullness of life. The very name of Jesus means that God saves. God's present work, He's present, He's at work, He's saving in our time and place, right here, right now. Having saved us, Jesus makes the entirety of the spiritual life lived in a relationship with God accessible to you and I today. So the word salvation, it's a fuller, deeper, more rich of a word than maybe we first thought. It's a beautiful word. That salvation is the word that we'll be reflecting on today as we walk through this Good Friday service. So we'll be hearing from three different communicators throughout the service who will each focus on one element of that idea of salvation. We'll look at the past, what Jesus did on the cross. Then we'll look at the present. What is the life that Jesus is offering to us today? And then ultimately we will look at the future idea of salvation. What hope do we have for the future based on what Jesus did on the Good Friday? But before we jump in and we sing and we reflect on Jesus' sacrifice, let's just take a moment and pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your Son. We are so thankful for the sacrifice that He has made on that cross and the significance and the meaning and the salvation that it brings to each and every one of us. May the death of Jesus not be too familiar to us. May it not be just something that we go through the motions, but may today we be reminded of the sacredness of that, of the beauty that's found in Jesus. May today, Lord, would you, Holy Spirit, would you come and give us ears to hear, eyes to see. Holy Spirit, would you renew something in us? Would this truth, would it go so down deep into our souls? May we be transformed yet again by the good news of Jesus. Holy Spirit, would you work something in us? May we receive, as we reflect on the goodness of Jesus, may we receive something fresh today. So Jesus, may we just see you more clearly today and more beautiful. We ask all this in your beautiful name. Amen.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son. His treasure. How great the pain of searing love. The Father turns His face away. His wounds which mar the chosen one. Bring many sons to the perfect Son of God, in all his innocence, you're walking in the dirt with you and me. He knows what living is, he secretes it with our grief. A man of sorrow, son of suffering.
I have three children. My younger two are still at the age when imaginative play takes them on adventures. Captivated by stories of rings of power and quests to save kingdoms, they head out to the far reaches of the townhouse complex under the shadow of the woods that stand along the southern borders of the fence, with backpacks full of granola bars and apples, and an old broomstick in hand to fend off dragons, or as it may be, coyotes. Does it ever feel like our journey of faith is on some level a game of make-believe? The story is ancient and distant enough to feel like lore, and at a cursory glance, it seems crazy enough to put aside as myth. Do you ever wonder, is this for real? The story goes like this. In the beginning, God made the world and all that was in it, landforms, skies, and seas, animals and plants and people made in his own image. He made them all good. God told his people, Adam and Eve, that he loved them and would take care of them as long as they trusted him, for he really was good to them and he loved them dearly. But one day, Adam and Eve were deceived and doubted God's love and goodness to them, so they disobeyed God, deciding for themselves that the fruit he told them not to eat was actually good to eat, and he was withholding from them. Well, the fruit was not good for them, and he did not deceive them, but they were deceived by another, and in their distrust and their disobedience, they were condemned to die. But God still loved his people dearly, and he promised that one day he would rescue them from their sin, their guilt and shame, and he would save them from the death their sin deserved. He would bring life and goodness back to them and the world. And so many years later, God came down as a man named Jesus, which means rescuer. But there were some people who hated Jesus. They didn't want people to listen to Jesus teach. They didn't want Jesus healing people or bringing people who had died back to life. They knew that if everyone listened to Jesus, no one would listen to them. So they decided to kill Jesus on the cross. But remember, Jesus was not just man. He was also God. He didn't have to die. He allowed himself to be killed because he knew it would be the only way of rescue. He who had never sinned took everyone's sin, yours and mine, from all ages, from all lands. He bore that sin upon himself and took the deathly consequences of all that sin. And doing so, he delivered us from sin and death so we could be alive and good again. He died so we would not have to. He freed us from sin and death forever. But there's more to this story, and it only gets better from there, as Devin and Amy will tell us. But is it just a story? Are we, like my kids, at imaginative play? Is the history true enough to handle the day-to-day dirt tracked into our entryways? Can it enter our reality in a way that means something? On an ancient, actual night, when a star shone bright, God did enter our reality. He came as a little baby, and he died upon a Roman cross, and it's there on the cross where his love breaks our barriers, where the justification of our sin is no mythological fable nor theological abstraction. No, the historical evidence is solid. It was real. The whips of leather tipped with metal and bone were real enough to crack the sound barrier and shred through his flesh, over and over until he was alive, just enough to endure further torture. The weight of the wooden crossbeam that Jesus dragged through the streets towards Golgotha was real enough to enforce the law of gravity, pulling Jesus, raw from the whipping, down with it. Nails, 6 inches of iron forged and tapered to a sharp point, were real enough to pierce and hold Jesus' hands and feet. I'm not trying to glorify the violence and brutality. We need to remember well and remember often his death and sacrifice, because every bead of sweat and every drop of blood was shed broadly for the world, but particularly for you and for me. Know too that it was more than just physical pain that he suffered. Jesus had never been apart from his beloved Father. They'd always been together with and within the Holy Spirit, mutually submitting and lifting each other up in holy and eternal waves of life and love. But this unity was severed when Jesus took our sin upon himself. This separation too was not abstract. It was as real as the separation between the sun and its own light for three dark midday hours till Jesus cried his last. It was as real as the full tear through 12 inches of thick curtain, the one that hung before the Holy of Holies in the temple. It was as real as a split of rock as the earth trembled. It was a mighty separation that shuddered through the cosmos. Real death, real pain, real separation. His and ours. His for ours, for isn't our pain, the pain we suffered and the pain we've inflicted, our brokenness, our tears, aren't they real? And doesn't our world need a real solution? Not the ones they come up with in the bureaucracies of self-protection and self-promotion. No, real death, because our sin is real, as is the death that was our consequence. So when Jesus took our sin on our behalf, he wasn't playing make-believe. The wickedness, the vileness, the enormity of it all, those of Nineveh, those of the Rwandan genocide, those of your neighbor, those of your enemy, those that lie within the darkness of our own hearts. He really bore it all and all of the consequences, the pain, the death, the descent. He bore it for us. And as for us, who could do nothing for ourselves, we in turn are forgiven and given the righteousness of Jesus. We are considered pure and blameless. Again, it's not theater, it's not pretend. We don't don the robes of righteousness while our real selves lie underneath, still accused and ashamed. We're not just putting on costumes. His death really sets us free from our sin and death. We have been fully and forever forgiven. We are free to be alive and good. We are transformed by the cross. 1 Corinthians 5:21 says, God made Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of Christ. As real as a cross is, as real as the power of God to rescue us is, you can see in the thing itself, so also is the love of God. Jesus staked his life to rescue us. It's not a love that's ephemeral and idealistic. It's a love that's real as wood and iron, as real as blood and tears, as real as you and me. A love that is indeed the form and filling of reality. It's a love that makes us real. But maybe it is this love, this incredible grace, that is the crux of what makes the whole thing so hard to believe, so difficult to realize. Why, God, do you care so much? Why is your love so intent upon us? Loved as we are, free as we are yet implicated in his death. We owe him our whole selves. We are tethered by his sacrifice. His nail-scarred hands have a sure hold of us. Nothing will separate us from his love, not our sin, not our guilt, not death. Don't be deceived. Do not let lies and half-truths with their illegitimate and passing power tell you that we are not dearly loved, not completely forgiven, not fully free from death, that we should be afraid and ashamed, or that this is but shadow and metaphor, only a beautiful ideal. Come to the cross. Come often and with others. Linger and be transformed by the undeniable truth of his great, undeserved, but sweetly given love. Let Jesus, who is himself truth, take hold of you as he tells you again and again, have no fear, for I have redeemed you. I've called you by name. You are mine.
If you're able, would you stand with us? Let's sing a couple more songs together.
Death, I claimed its victory. The King of life is living up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse is blood atoned. Final breath, and it was finished. But not the end we could. For the earth began to shake, the veil was torn. What sacrifice as the heavens roar. Crossed eternity. hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Savior of the world. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Savior of the world.
He stood up. cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor. And honor to me.
You may be seated.
Second Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. As Christians, those who have been saved by Christ's sacrifice, we are offered a new life in him. It is a gift to us. We are justified. However, praise be to the Lord, because that is not where our story ends. We are not only forgiven, but we also do not have to be, and the Bible actually tells us we are no longer bound by the sin that once held us down. As Paul puts it in this passage, we are a new creation. God has not left us to remain where we were when he saved us, but he actually offers us a continuous freedom from who we still are. This is where we get the word sanctification. This concept and this word at its foundation, it actually means to set apart or to make holy. And it is the idea that God continually makes his sons and daughters to be more and more like Jesus Christ every day. And we are in dire need of this because, unfortunately, as saved humans, we are still human. We will make mistakes. We will mess up. We will sin. But the purpose of this is not that we would be perfect, but rather that we would understand and live in the reality that the Holy Spirit empowers us to pursue holiness every day. Paul puts or discusses this in Romans 6:19 when he says, previously, you let yourselves be slaves to impurity and lawlessness, which led ever deeper into sin. Now, you must give yourselves to be slaves to righteous living so that you will become holy. As we were once slaves to our sinful ways, meaning that we could not escape them, we now are to intentionally make ourselves slaves to the righteousness that God has gifted to us. It is a beautiful, beautiful picture of God's grace in our life. Now, last Saturday, I had an awesome opportunity of going to the Canucks game. My friend Josh gifted me with his second ticket. It was such a blessing, and we went together. It was really fun. He is a huge Flames fan. I am a huge Canucks fan, and they were playing each other, so it was perfect. The Canucks won pretty decisively, so I objectively had a better night than he did, but we still had fun. And as we were leaving our seats and we enter like the ring that has all the food and the merch and whatnot, he spots way off in the distance amongst the sea of people a booth that is selling signed Calgary Flames jerseys. Now, keep in mind, Josh is through and through by trade a jersey collector. He cannot resist sometimes the purchase of getting a new jersey. So we go over to the booth, he wants to look at them, and as we get closer and closer, his eyes just get wider and wider as he sees these jerseys. He sees his most famous, or the most famous and his most favorite Flames players and their signatures, ignoring the absurd prices below the jerseys, and he just wants one so bad. And the longer we linger, obviously the more tempted he is to actually get one, but then he realizes that he shouldn't. It's a bad decision, and he like half starts to walk away, and he's like, oh man, Devin, don't let me do this, man. Don't let me get a jersey. Please don't let me do it. And he's walking away, but he's still looking back. He's like, oh man, don't let me do it, Devin. And I didn't know what to do. It was pretty funny, but I kind of just stood between Josh and the jerseys that he was looking at, and I just like took little steps, and it was just reminding him, like, hey man, they're regular people like you and me. The signatures don't mean that much. It's okay. You don't need to get a jersey. And we just kept walking and walking and walking, and slowly he convinced himself that he didn't need to. And finally, at one point, he didn't look back anymore, and he didn't care about the jerseys. And by the time we got to the car, he didn't even mention them. He was not worried about losing this jersey. Now, I think this picture of me standing between Josh and the jerseys that he wanted is quite a beautiful picture of the Holy Spirit sanctifying work in our life. Though we are now justified by our sins, we still have a tendency to look back at our past desires and still have a temptation to fall back into who we were. But God, in his great grace, willingly chooses to stand in between us and our fallen desires. And he just reminds us gently that this is the path I've laid out before you now. He just keeps taking little steps, ushering us along in our foolishness, whispering in our ear, I've called you to a greater path. This is not what you need anymore. Devin, this apathy that you once had is not what you need anymore. Devin, this cynicism that you once had is not what you need anymore. He reminds us time and time again that this is not what we need to be looking back at. It's interesting observing myself in this process of sanctification in my life, and I'm sure people in here can relate that the more I choose to look forward and focus on what God is calling me to instead of looking back at my past self, the less and less I care about the things that I left behind. The more I focus on the Lord and listen to His voice, the more and more I'm passionate about what He wants instead of what I want. I find the more I give up, the more free I actually am. And the more I yield to His Spirit and to His calling and to His word, the more sanctified I become. And this is the whole point of Christ working in us. So then, in light of this, my friends, be encouraged that it is not by your own strength that you carry out this life saved by God. It is not a requirement of you. Philippians 2:13 says, "For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him." He continually empowers us by His Holy Spirit. And just as He did not expect you to do the hard work of the cross, He does not expect you to do the hard work of your sanctification either. We are to rely on His Spirit, His leading, and it is simply our job to listen to Him and to obey. And we rely on Him to pursue holiness because, as Paul reminds us in Galatians 5:1, for freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Choose to rely on the Lord instead of your own strength. Choose to listen to His leading and His voice instead of looking at your own past desires.
finished upon that cross, and onward to eternal glory, to my Savior and my God, I rejoice in Jesus' victory. It was finished upon that cross, it was finished upon that cross, it was finished upon that cross. The voice of Jesus on the cross of Calvary, he declares his work is finished, he has spoken this hope to me.
You may be seated.
Humanity, a beautiful, diverse bouquet of culture and language, tradition and custom. However, something I believe whispers the truth of a greater reality is the common experience of longing. Longing for significance, to justify our existence. That our presence on this earth was not for nothing. Did we really matter? Did we use it well? Did we make it count? To be loved, to be worthy, to be successful, to be admired, whatever it is. So we are drawn to the things we believe will bring this satisfaction about. We build our reputation, relationships, careers, achievements, the things we believe make us justified, valuable, worth it. Even Madonna has said, "My drive in life comes from a fear of being mediocre, to push past one spell of it and discover myself as a special human being, but then I still feel mediocre and uninteresting unless I do something else." We continue to strive for ultimate fulfillment, more, bigger, better, the next thing, that will be it. Like grasping the wind, it is in vain. Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." What if? What if it's true? As Sandra said, what if it's for real? All of it. If our world is broken, and it wouldn't take much to be convinced of that, that this brokenness has actually separated us from a holy and perfect God. For sin has wrapped its tentacles around every human heart. The finite reality of our lives, striving, aging, decaying, we fight so hard. We deny our common, exhausting existence that culminates ultimately in death. We grieve and fear its finality. As we've just sung, death was once my great opponent, yet God could not stand for it. What if it's true? What if it's not the end? What if there was something more? What if there is something more, and God, in his deepest being, wanted for us to know it, to know true love and fulfillment? So his perfect, spotless Son was commissioned, sent to this place, broken and dim, so that we could know love wholly and completely. That our deepest yearnings would be fulfilled and true love could reign in and over us forever. Could it really be? Could it really be that we could live with a sense of true love and fulfillment forever, everlasting? While we can hardly fathom it, more than just us living this finite earthly life, we are not promised anything, let alone peace, love, and security indefinitely, forever. However, Scripture guarantees it. Eternal life. Do we even know what our very souls are longing for, what we're actually striving for? When we say all of our hope is in Jesus, because the merit we've built, exhausting ourselves, is not it. It is not the answer to fulfillment. And it's already been said today, this favor, this grace, this gift of unmerited love of God is not because of us. It is because of Jesus. The gift of eternal life, we've cheapened eternity. Heaven, the pearly gates, we've reduced it to caricatures of angels on clouds with harps. Because to hold a satiating view of heaven would loosen the frenetic chokehold our worldly reality has on us. What if it's really true? Can we even fathom an eternity that would truly satisfy our souls? In his book, The Weight of Glory, C.S. Lewis sums this up perfectly. It would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered to us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what it's meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far, far too easily pleased. Don't be insulted. I'll pose this question to you to bring this quote to life. If a good God designed us with longings for a continual search for fulfillment and deep purpose, do we not think the destination he has ultimately designed us to dwell eternally would fulfill those deepest desires? That is the eternal reality. Deepest peace, love, and joy that nothing in this world, nothing even in this very moment, the very best of the best, the most elated of feelings, the deepest of love and affection, it is a mere shadow of the fulfillment, the security, the purpose, and love we will experience. An existence fulfilled and satisfied forever. But mixed in with this heavenly anticipation is still our daily reality. As Devin said, we are still human, which is heavy, it is burdensome, it is painful. But when we view our current struggles in the light of eternity, when the Apostle Paul talks about these light and momentary afflictions, which if you know anything about Paul, his suffering was neither light nor momentary. But in light of eternity, they were. And so are ours. Because of Jesus, we get the credit on a group project we put zero help into. All of the inheritance for perfection that should have been Jesus's alone has been lavished upon us. When Jesus chose to die on the cross so we could experience everlasting fulfillment of love that the Father wants to lavish upon us. So while there is already so much freedom, simply unleashed by the embrace and the acknowledgement of the death of Jesus, as Sandra spoke about, and a life that is continuously being drawn closer to Christ, as Devin spoke about, more is on the way. Today we live in anticipation of eternity. Hosanna in the highest. So we're going to move now into a time of communion. as we meditate on salvation, what it's done for us, what it's doing, and what is to come, let us never forget the brutality of Jesus' death on a cross so we could receive this gift, so we could receive this inheritance. This is the practice of communion, when you can reflect on what you should have got but didn't, and what you received instead. I often pray, God, remind me of your holiness so that I am in awe of your mercy and grace. We don't like to think of God as intolerant, but when we take a minute to understand his intolerance of sin, because anything less than life-giving cannot be in the presence of God, it helps us to put into perspective both our need for God's grace, we can't do it without God, but also the fact that this separation was all of our own choosing. God, in his great mercy, made a way for us to live without being separated or condemned through his own sacrifice, his beloved son, Jesus. Would you stand with me? The communion hosts are going to hand out communion. I believe everything in the trays today is gluten-free. Would you hold on to that, as today we are going to partake in communion together? As God sent his son Jesus, and as Jesus would be mocked, degraded, humiliated, taunted, and as Sandra chronicled so vividly, his physical body was tortured and bruised and beaten. He responded not with, "You'll get yours," or "Just you wait." No. His response was mercy. He responded with, "Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do." What should sober us about this historical event is not thinking just of his physical suffering. While horrific, this kind of practice is still not uncommon in our world, to dehumanize and to torture. What should sober us is the reality of the soul hell Jesus endured. He went to the very depths of hell, to the place completely void of the goodness and true love of God. Think of every failure and pain you replay in your mind when you close your eyes. All your mistakes, every moment of personal regret that makes you cringe, and every moment of injustice either perpetrated against you or makes your blood boil for another. Think of every single one. He put them on. He wore them as his own, claiming the shameful credit of humanity. Perfect, spotless Jesus was now marred and drenched in the smell of death and decay and depravity. And in response, his father turned his face away. Jesus, now separated from his loving father, the most anguishing part of it all. The bleakness of death and its finality, an eternity without hope and love, Jesus cried, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani? My God, why have you abandoned me?" Sandra said, a mighty separation. The darkness was overwhelming. A reality that each one of us should face, an eternal punishment for our selfishness, our greed, our self-seeking. The perfect Son of God took that for us. Jesus paid it all, and to all, to him I owe. The Apostle Paul chronicles this in 1 Corinthians. the Last Supper, when Jesus knew what was about to happen. In 1 Corinthians 11, it says, "For I have received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's partake of the bread together. In the same way, after supper, he took this cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood." Meaning no more striving, no more trying to make it, no more getting into heaven on your own merit. "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's partake of the cup together. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are reminded of what should have been yours, but is not. But you are also reminded of what is yours, that you did nothing to earn. Let us not forget. Hosanna in the highest.
Thank you.
I pray that out of his glorious riches he may. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. We love you. We'll see you soon.